Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in to LabPadre, SpaceX, and Starbase weekly updates. We've got another good one for you today, so let's dig in. Starting things off in Florida, a new hexagonal water deluge system loop was installed at the base of the Starship launch mount at Cape Canaveral Launch Complex 39A. Friday wrapped up in Texas with the integration tower's chopsticks positioned to put Booster 7 on the orbital launch mount. On Saturday morning, a Falcon 9 lifted off from Space Launch Complex 40 at the Cape, carrying Intelsat's Galaxy 33 and 34 satellites into geosynchronous transfer orbit. During the launch, Doug returned to port, would just read the instructions in Booster 1077, which lofted Crew 5 to the International Space Station. Just 3 hours later, crews lifted Booster B-1077 onto the dock for transport and refurbishment at Roberts Road. Turning to Boca Chica, Starship 26's nose cone assembly was moved from high bay to mid bay overnight into Sunday morning. That afternoon at the launch site, a Raptor was lifted by crane onto the Raptor maintenance platform for later installation on the booster. Once the engine was detached from the crane, it was wrapped up in protective gray tarp. Continuing work at the launch site, workers removed several hold-down clamps from the launch mount before replacing them a few hours later. Late in the afternoon, the Raptor maintenance table was lowered from under the launch mount ahead of Booster 7's lift. On Monday morning, Booster 10's methane tank section was lifted onto one of the welding turntables in the mega bay. About an hour later, Booster 7 began to be lifted for replacement on the orbital launch mount. Over the next hour, the orbital launch integration tower cautiously lifted the vehicle off the transport stand and above the launch mount before swinging over and carefully lowering it into place. Later in the afternoon, the chopsticks released Booster 7 and returned to resting position over the vehicle lift staging area. With Booster 7 securely in place, the Raptor center engine on the Raptor work platform was lifted for installation on the vehicle. Seen here in infrared, the booster's quick disconnect panel was connected to Booster 7 later that evening. About 10 minutes later, the Starship lifting pins on the chopsticks were ready to be rotated to their lifting position. With everything with the vehicles and launch facilities seeming to be in place, Starship 24 was moved into position for a full vehicle stack. Over at the Cape, Doug and Just Read the Instructions left port in support of the upcoming Hotbird 13F mission. Early on Tuesday morning, Ship 24's lift was called off and the chopsticks were lowered to their resting position. The bumpers on the chopstick rails, which are designed to protect the booster during a catch, were interfering with Ship 24's heat shields and needed to be removed. Once the bumpers were removed, the chopsticks were raised into place again for the lift and stacking of Starship 24. B6.1, another article being built for structural testing, had its ship skirt section brought from the mid-bay to Sanchez. While this was taking place, a grid fin was installed on the top dome of section Booster 9. 4 days after being brought to the docks at Port Canaveral, Falcon 9 Booster B-1077 was laid down for later transport. Finally, with a setting sun, having completed all launch pad system checkouts, and after some adjustments to the chopsticks, Starship 24 was lifted on Booster 7. As the ship hung over the booster, the Starship quick disconnect arm was brought onto position before the ship was lowered into place. Over at the build site, the common dome section for Starship 26 was moved into the high bay. Starship 26's mid-lock section followed the common dome into the bay about 45 minutes later. With both ship sections in place, the common dome and mid-lock section were lifted onto a welding turntable together. Assembly work on Booster 9 continued in Mega Bay with the installation of a second grid fin. The launch tower's quick disconnect interface arm was guided into place and attached to Ship 24 around 1 a.m. Wednesday morning. The quick disconnect was retracted from the ship at its apparent full speed for launch about an hour later. At roughly 2:40 a.m., the quick disconnect was reattached to Ship 24. The quick disconnect was once again retracted, this time at a more sedated pace early in the afternoon. A couple of hours later, Starship 24 was unmated and lifted slightly off Booster 7. Workers proceeded to inspect the ship and booster on a boom lift to mitigate any apparent issues in stack. With their work complete, Ship 24 was lowered back onto Booster 7 with noticeably less wobble in the process. Late that night at Port Canaveral, Dragon Recovery Ship Megan headed to sea in support of the Crew 4 mission and splashed down. Early on Thursday morning, the high-speed quick disconnect retraction test was repeated on the reseated stack. Back at the Cape, Bob and Shortfall of Gravitas returned to port with the fairing halves and booster from the Galaxy 3334 mission. The lifting cap was soon attached to booster B1060 for offloading from the landing ship. While crews worked to prep the booster, the recovered fairing halves were likewise offloaded from Bob with an articulated crane. After 2 hours of prep, Falcon 9 booster B1060 was lifted onto the docks ahead of fold-up and transport. Returning to Boca Chica, another prefabricated flight of stairs, destined for the fixed-level work platforms, was brought onto Mega Bay. Late in the evening, some temporary scaffolding was erected on the quick disconnect arm around the ship interface panel. Photographers Greg Scott and Farrielle Mohan once again took to the skies on Wednesday and brought us another amazing set of flyover photos from Cape Canaveral. At the base of the Falcon 9 tower, the transporter erector sits awaiting its next assignment following reconfiguration earlier in the week to prepare for a Falcon Heavy launch. With the USSF 44 mission launching as soon as the 31st, the transporter erector will soon roll down the ramp to the horizontal assembly facility where the joined Falcon 9 boosters B1064, B1065, and B1066 will be mated with the payload and prepared for launch. Between the two towers, work continues on the new tanks being built near what is likely the liquid oxygen part of the Starship tank farm. Concrete base now appears complete, and some of the scaffolding has been removed from around the tank sections, but both the inner and outer top domes are still awaiting installation. Work is still progressing on the nearby Starship launch tower as well. After being used late last week to install the launch mount deluge ring, the LR-11350 was seen using its auxiliary hook to lift smaller components during the flyover. Just a few miles to the south lies SpaceX's other Cape launch facility, Space Launch Complex 40. While no Falcon 9s were visible on the pad during the flyover, just days after this photo was taken, the Hotbird 13F mission launched from here, the 23rd launch from this busy site just this year. Let's move about 5 miles to the southwest to SpaceX's facilities at Roberts Road, which, like Launch Complex 39A, services both the Falcon 9 and the Starship programs. Hangar X, located on the east side of the facility, is where SpaceX refurbishes their Falcon 9s between flights. Recent expansion of the building appears to now be complete. The northern parking lot, finally being paved and painted, appears to have been one of the finishing touches for this half of the facility. Just to the west of Hangar X is the Starship Launch Tower assembly area. While we've been seeing signs for a while that SpaceX was prepping to build another launch tower here, this week construction of the third Starship launch tower finally started. The first module of the tower is already assembled, complete with a hard stop for the chopsticks. Next to it, construction of the second module is well underway. Nearby, the four columns as well as an interconnecting steel beams are staged for the third module. In that same area, we can also see the cable chain for the 39A tower awaiting transport to its tower. Currently, SpaceX has the jig bases installed for the construction of 6 modules, with the bases for a 7th on the ground nearby. Interestingly, while SpaceX is moving quickly with assembling this new tower, there has not been any sightings of foundations for it seen around the Cape. Where do you think Mechazilla number 3 will go? Let us know in the comments. Just to the west of the Tower 3 construction, work is progressing on the other components needed for the 39A launch tower. The gas springs and pistons for the landing beam on the chopsticks have now been added. The nearby carriage has had the first of its claw-like extensions added, while workers have started to add piping and conduit into the QD arm. Behind the chopsticks, crews have been working on the end of the QD arm, and we can now see the steel for the extendable work platform staged next to it. Just to the south of this work, the Roberts Road Star Factory is being built at a remarkable pace. The steelwork has nearly caught up to the concrete slab as roughly 3/4 of the building structure seems to be up. Work is still ongoing for the underground mechanicals and the foundations for the final section of the building, which will be the taller nose cone end of the Star Factory. Peeking through the door at the other end of the facility, appears that crews are working to pour the concrete slab that was skipped over that area. On the final corner of the Roberts Road Starship site, progress on the Mega Bay seems to be at a bit of a standstill. While the building's foundations have been complete for a while now, and the steel has been staged, no steel has yet been installed. While it's not immediately clear why progress is halted, it seems apparent that SpaceX is preparing to work quickly and efficiently as soon as work continues. The yellow crane is still stationed inside the building's footprint and looks poised to start erecting the first layer of steel any day. While outside, the black crane seems ready to start assembling the corners of the other levels on the pads to lift into place once the first level is complete. Moving away from the SpaceX sites, let's move a few miles south to Blue Origin's Cape Canaveral production facility. Like SpaceX, Blue Origin is also working on expansion. Massive groundwork dominates the southern half of their site. A large newly graded parking area is surrounded by additional ground clearing and grading operations. A large temporary building has also been assembled nearby. The southwestern corner of the site is being used as a staging ground for the expansion of the nearby warehouse building. Steel work on that expansion seems to be moving along at a steady clip now, with more than a quarter of the steel now in place. Greg and Farrielle also caught something new and interesting this week just north of NASA's Vehicle Assembly Building. This newly assembled LR-1300 crane is sitting between stationary mounting points for SLS's mobile launch platforms. Given the crane's size and location, not to mention that crawler transport number one is sitting nearby, it is possible that they are preparing for work on the second mobile launcher, which NASA will need for the future Artemis missions. Another interesting spot this week was a United States Marine-branded McDonnell Douglas DC-9 sitting next to the runway at the shuttle landing facility. While it's not clear exactly why this plane was at Kennedy, it appears that the U.S. Air Force has given the retired Marine Corps aircraft new life as a sensor testbed. Let's wrap up this week's flyover with a quick tour through some of the other facilities at the Cape at Port Canaveral. United Launch Alliance's Launch Complex 41 sits between SpaceX's two launch sites and recently launched the Atlas V, SES 20 and 21 mission, and still has two launches scheduled before the end of the year. Moving 6 miles south down the coast, we come to Relativity Space's Launch Complex 16. Having rolled their first Terran 1 first stage back inside the hangar prior to the recent hurricane, CEO Tim Ellis has said that they are currently working on final vehicle integration prior to rolling the 3D printed rocket back to the pad for a static fire and then the company's first orbital launch attempt. A few miles south is Blue Origin's Launch Complex 36, where they hope to launch their New Glenn rocket as soon as next year. Space Launch Complex 46 sits at the southeastern tip of the Cape Canaveral Space Force Station and is currently sitting dormant following Astra's two failed launch attempts from it earlier this year. Astra is now regrouping and moving on from their Rocket 3 and focusing on their upgraded Rocket 4. Dragon recovery vessel Megan was spotted docked in Port Canaveral just hours before it headed out to sea and later successfully recovered Crew Dragon Freedom and the Crew 4 astronauts. Nearby, a very clean-looking Falcon 9 booster B-1077 sat on the dock awaiting transport to Hangar X for refurbishment after its inaugural launch last week when it set the Crew 5 mission to the International Space Station. And there you have it, another LabPadre SpaceX and Starbase weekly update with a splash of Blue Origin, Astra, Relativity Space, and ULA. We'll see you next week, and thanks for watching. LabPadre out.